Gone. All right, we will both speak up. How about that? Well, it's my great pleasure to welcome Larry Brilliant this evening. And I thought that rather than my making up an introduction, I'm going to read you the book jacket. Oh. Just because it'll embarrass him. And that's a good way to start any discussion. So when a powerful mystic steps on the hand of a radical young hippie doctor from Detroit, it changes lives and the world. Sometimes Brilliant chronicles the adventure of a philosopher, seeker, unconventional doctor, groundbreaking tech innovator, and key player in the eradication of one of the worst pandemics in human history. His story about what happens when love, compassion, and determination meet the right circumstances to effect positive change is the kind that keeps hope and the sense of possibility alive. And believe me, we need that right about now. After sitting at the feet of Martin Luther King Jr. at the University of Michigan in 1963, Larry Brilliant was swept up into the civil rights movement, marching and protesting across America and Europe. As a radical young doctor, he followed the hippie trail from London over the Khyber Pass with his wife, Garija, Wavy Gravy, and the hog farm commune to India. There, he found himself in a Himalayan ashram, wondering whether he had stumbled into a cult. Instead, one of India's greatest spiritual teachers, Neem Karoli Baba, opened Larry's heart and told him his destiny was to work for the WHO to help eradicate deadly smallpox. He never would have believed he'd become a key player in eliminating a 10,000-year-old disease that killed more than 500 million people in the 20th century alone. Brilliant's unlikely trajectory, chronicled in Sometimes Brilliant, has brought him into close proximity with political leaders, spiritual masters, cultural heroes, and titans of technology around the world, from the Grateful Dead to Mikhail Gorbachev, from Ram Dass, the Dalai Lama, Lama Govinda, and Karmapa, to Steve Jobs and the founders of Google, Salesforce, Facebook, Microsoft, and eBay, and Presidents Carter, Clinton, Bush, and Obama, W. Bush, anchored by the engrossing account of the heroic efforts of the extraordinary people involved in smallpox eradication in India. This is a riveting and fascinating epidemiological expedition, an honest reckoning of an entire generation, and a deeply moving spiritual memoir. It's a testament to faith, love, service, and what it means to engage with life's most important questions in the pursuit of a better, more brilliant existence.
Are we done now?
Well, it was certainly better said than I would have said, whatever I would have said.
I didn't write that.
So he didn't write it, but we do have some books, and I encourage people to take one home with a signature. But we get to talk about, well, I'm going to keep hold on to it. We're going to have a conversation, and we're going to open it up so people can ask questions. And I'm going to start. This has been an extraordinarily difficult period. I just got back from Mexico on Sunday. The view from there is just mind-boggling. And I landed in an airport with people being turned back. But right before I went to Mexico, I spent 4 days at the School of Public Health at Emory, where they have, I think, the only joint program in theology and public health that offers a joint degree. And one of the things I think that's very interesting about your history is the way you've brought spirituality and religion into juxtaposition. I'm sorry, spirituality and religion. Spirituality, religion, and public health into juxtaposition with each other. I started my career in public health in Africa, where some 75% of healthcare is delivered, at least it was, by faith-based organizations. But here we are in Berkeley, which is not exactly known for, it may be known for being very spiritual, but certainly not very religious. And we don't have a theology school. We certainly don't have a joint degree. You know, one of the things that I'd love to have you comment on is not only that relationship, but how you feel about the role of morality and goodness and its relationship to public health, how that's different today than it was a few months ago.
Well, first, thank you for inviting me, and thank you for coming. It's really nice to see a lot of old friends and a lot of new faces.
You need to speak up.
I need to speak up?
Yeah.
I'm the one who was just practicing speaking up, and I forgot. So we're talking about God and public health, and somehow we got to talk about, you know, Trump in the middle of that. He doesn't fit in either of the first two categories. You know, I remember being mad at God for almost a whole decade, from the time I saw the first child die of smallpox, which was actually a fellow named Bill Fagey, who is, you know, the legendary, wonderful, my mentor, but everybody else I think is mentor also. Bill, whose father was a Lutheran minister, his grandfather was a Lutheran minister, and I used to joke that Bill Fagey was the best advertisement for Jesus Christ in the world, because you meet Bill Fagey, you want to eat what he eats, you want to drink what he drinks, you want to believe what he believes, because he's such a great human being. But he took me to see my first case of smallpox, which was in a little village in a county, a district, a zila, called Merritt, outside of New Delhi. And we went into this village and we were trying to find any cases of smallpox. And smallpox in India at that time, for some people, was synonymous with a deity, a goddess named Shitala Ma, the cooling mother. And when Shitala Ma visited the house, you weren't supposed to have any strangers come in. And so smallpox was hidden. That wasn't the only reason smallpox was hidden. There was nothing you could do if somebody had smallpox. There's no antiviral. There's no mitigating therapy you could do. And one out of three people who got it would die. And some of the bad kinds of smallpox, hemorrhagic smallpox, flat smallpox, hemorrhagic smallpox, which had a particularly cruel predisposition for pregnant women, and 100% fatality rate. And so we walked into this village. I'm with Bill Fagey. He was and still is 6'8". And we looked a little bit like Mutt and Jeff. And we walked into this village, and we couldn't find any cases of smallpox. And they were hiding them, and Bill said, I spoke Hindi, and Bill said, tell everybody the tallest man in the world has come. And I did, and all the kids came to see the tallest man in the world. And then we found what we wanted, which was a case of smallpox, and I almost vomited. I mean, I didn't know what to do. You know, I was trained as a physician. I had no job after medical school. This was my first job. I wanted to call 911. I mean, there was no, I mean, I'd never seen anyone that sick. I'd never seen anyone suffer that much. And because smallpox, it's not just that you have lesions all over your fingers, you have lesions in your eyes. It caused 10% of all the blindness in the world at one time. And you also have lesions inside of your throat. You can't swallow, you can't urinate. I mean, you would have to think that God was either a very cruel sadist, or that she was a terrible manager. I couldn't square the circle of faith and that degree of suffering. I couldn't believe that reincarnation, karma, were an adequate compensation for suffering like that. And I had been living in an ashram. I'd been studying Hinduism and Buddhism and Islam and Judaism and Christianity. And there was no place in any religion that I could find a justification for that kind of suffering. And it took me, I was lucky enough that I would go on weekdays. I'd work on smallpox. Weekends, I'd go see my guru, who lived in the Himalayas in an ashram in a very exotic place right at the corner of India, Nepal, and Tibet. Put your finger there, and that's where I lived. And I would say to him, what the fuck? I mean, really, in how could there be a world in which there is an omnipotent, omniscient, merciful, and kind, and loving deity that's all-powerful and all-knowing, and yet children die like this? And he would, over a period of 6 months, have me read the Dhammapada, the Bhagavad Gita, passages that tried to explain and balance the whatever religion it was that we were reading, the Torah, the Talmud, you know, how theologians had tried to balance the justification for a world that had such suffering in it with a merciful and omnipotent God. And after a while, because we could end it, and because my teacher had said to me that God was going to lift this one form of suffering. Buddha always said, you know, suffering will always be with you. Old age, suffering, and death are always there. That's the essence of the beginning of Theravada Buddhism, the beginning of Buddhism. But my teacher said, yes, suffering will always be there, but this one kind is going to be eliminated. This is God's gift to humanity. He also said this is God's gift to humanity because of the hard work of dedicated public health workers. And I saw smallpox disappear. So it was, for me, the depths of depression of seeing children die of smallpox, and then the heights of exhilaration of seeing the last case of the last case of killer smallpox. And I think that lasted for me until my son died. And then I went through that same period of not being able to find a way to not be angry at God. And it's only recently that I've come out of that black hole. But I can't answer, of course, I have a cop-out, and I say this is all above my pay grade, which is the way that I've kind of come to deal with that. But I think that watching Trump and watching the hate that he is broadcasting has made me think again about the same kind of thoughts that I had when I wondered how you justify something this harmful, and the kind of particular joy he seems to express in ridiculing other people, not just people who are handicapped, but the way he divides us and puts us into vertical buckets, makes us think we can't do anything, makes us think that we are helpless, makes us think that we need a strong man to protect us. These classic ways remind me of how I felt when I saw children dying of smallpox. I don't think it's that bad yet, and we've been through worse. We have to remind ourselves that there was a time when we had 40,000 nuclear weapons, and the Soviet Union and the U.S. had that many weapons pointing at each other. The Holocaust was much worse than this. We have to remind ourselves that our putting Japanese human beings into concentration camps was much worse than this. But you asked me out there, you know, what I wanted to convey about the book. I didn't start to write a book that addressed Trump or, you know, global politics. I wanted to write a book about the miracle of human beings from 170 countries, Muslims and Jews and Christians and Buddhists and Hindus and Baha'is, Jains, Shinto, working together to eradicate one of the worst diseases in history. I wanted to write about a time that Russians and Americans could take those 40,000 nuclear weapons and bury those 40,000 hatchets and work together against a common enemy. You know, if you ever read The Little Prince, he says, Exubery says, the true love consists not so much in looking into each other's eyes longingly as in looking together in the same direction at the far horizon. And that's what we did in smallpox. It is not so much a story just about the epidemiology. It's about the love that infused all of us to think that we could help eliminate one form of suffering forever. And I want to talk about that, because if you didn't know that we could eradicate smallpox and, please God, polio, that we could conquer, you know, Nazi Germany, we could do so many good things, you might forget that human beings are capable of doing anything good. Because right now, if you just watch television, you must, like me, whether you like Trump or hate Trump however you feel, you must think we are, as a species, completely incompetent and helpless. And I want to say we're not. And so I want to offer a proof point that we could do that. We could eradicate smallpox. We're this close to eradicating polio. There were under 20 cases in Pakistan last year, the whole year. I just got off the phone with a doctor in Pakistan right now. There have been no new cases in 2017. There are half a dozen cases in Afghanistan. That's it in the world. That's all there are. And we have to, in public health, because we are able to offer proof points. We're able to prove to the world what we can do that is good. And we can't allow ourselves to be paralyzed by the fear that creeps up. That is a technique that is being used to make us feel helpless. We can't succumb to it. If you are of a certain era, you grew up reading Dune and Dune Messiah and all these wonderful books, and the Bene Gesserit in Dune would always say that fear is the great mind killer. We can't allow ourselves to be afraid. We've got to remember Martin Luther King. We've got to remember Cesar Chavez. We've got to remember Gandhi. We've got to remember marching as we did last Saturday, or watching that march and feeling that once again we're part of a great and noble endeavor. And then I'll end my little spiel, which I hadn't I hadn't planned to do. But we were talking outside about Martin Luther King, and of course I was a dumb, stupid sophomore and depressed. My dad was dying. And I guess it's a theme in my life. And Martin Luther King showed up at the University of Michigan, and something got me out of my room where I'd locked myself in. And I went to see him, and he said, of course he said, that the moral arc of the universe, the arc of the moral universe, bends towards justice. But he didn't stop there. That is actually a Unitarian phrase that was first articulated by a Unitarian minister at Harvard College, way before Martin Luther King. And he said, the arc of the moral universe bends towards justice, but it's like an asymptote. Do you guys know? You know what an asymptote is. It's like something that keeps getting it. It'll never get there. The arc of the moral universe will never reach justice without you getting off of your ass and out of your chair and leaping up and grabbing that arc and pulling it and twisting and dragging it towards justice. So what he said and what he reminded us of was that we will get there, the good guys, the good gals, we will win, but we won't win without each one of us taking action and doing something and being part of it. And that's really good news, because over the next few years, we're going to need something to do. And we're going to need to remember that we can accomplish great and noble things together. And that having a job, having something to do, to bring that arc down towards justice, it's a gift. And we have to remind ourselves and poke ourselves and prod ourselves and remember that. And that's what I hope this book does.
You know, you mentioned thinking about where we are today and the divisions that you're talking about, they're correlated with a relatively secular coasts and a relatively religious center. Yet, I've worked for many years in HIV, and one of the most amazing things that's ever happened in HIV, and frankly in global health period, was when George W. Bush, in his State of the Union, announced the creation of PEPFAR, which was to a very large measure due to support from the evangelicals. In particular, Saddleback Church played an outsized role. And it was really the Lazarus effect of the fact that we now had treatment that could save people from dying. So I find this strange tension that we're in, where we have yet to find other ways to claim that sort of moral imperative to reduce inequity and to help our fellow humans. What do you see as opportunities for how you can take the experiences that you've lived, the kind of, you mentioned Bill Fagey being driven by his Lutheran faith. How do we re-engage that in common purpose rather than being distracted by the more minor things that divide us, the sort of secularists and the religious populations? I mean,
When I was 16, after I was bar mitzvahed, I was in confirmation class, and the rabbi, Rabbi Syme, gave us a writing assignment, which was to choose between God and science. And you knew what the right answer was. And I wrote something that I don't think you could be a really profound scientist if you hadn't asked yourself the questions of the meaning of life and why we're here. I mean, if you have an inquiring mind and you don't turn it on the biggest questions, you're missing the point. And I didn't think that you could be a person of faith and not use this glorious tool of science to not probe the universe and understand. So I said I chose both. He kicked me out of confirmation class. About 3 or 4 years ago, I was asked to be the keynote speaker at a gathering of all the rabbis in the United States, which was a scare. It's the scariest thing I've ever done. I mean, I'd rather face down a revolver pointed at me than all the rabbis. And I recounted that story of how I'd been kicked out of confirmation class. And the person who was the, I guess, the concierge of that, he took the microphone away from me and looked at all the rabbis and said, you know, that's 4 years in a row where the person who was the keynote speaker had been kicked out of confirmation class. What's going on here? And I think that's it. I mean, when I come to Berkeley, I think like we've all been kicked out of confirmation class. You don't need to be religious. You don't need to believe in anything. You don't need to be even a person of spiritual interest to fail to see that we're all in this together. I come to the same conclusion just in a secular way. I mean, when I was teaching, and I did teach for 2 years here. I taught international health. Is Art Reingold? Tell Art I called him out. But Art made me teach the international health course here, which I loved. And I was a professor at Michigan for a long time. And you may not know that we have the same school colors. I won't show you the M on the tie because, you know, I remember trying to get people to pay attention to global health. There wasn't a lot of interest in global health. All the interest was in medical care reimbursement and Steve Shortell and all this, you know, all Blue Cross stuff. Is Steve here? Where are you, Steve? Raise your hand. I remember, Steve. but you know, I my favorite slide when I was teaching that class was a slide of 25 kings and queens and emperors who had died of smallpox. And footnote, it wasn't because I liked seeing kings and queens and emperors die that I liked that. It was to remind me that no matter how rich you are, no matter how tall the gates of your gated community or how high your wall is, you can't be protected from a novel virus for which there's no antiviral and no vaccine. You'll get it, you'll die, just like the rest of us. Being rich and being powerful. And I am in this quizzical position of being now a creature of Silicon Valley. And my friends are the people you read about who started all these companies. Because I started a little bulletin board back in 1984 called The Well, and many of these companies were created using The Well. So I know all the founders and all these Medicis, all these victims of a new disease called sudden wealth syndrome. You may have heard of it. And they're as vulnerable as any one of us for a new pandemic potential disease. I saw Peter Thiel the other day did an interview, and he said he's bought property in New Zealand so all of his friends could go there if there was a pandemic. I got to tell you, whether it's Aspen or New Zealand, you don't want to go where all the rich people want to go if there's a pandemic, because one of them is going to go with the sniffles. They're not going to stay home and say, you know, I'm not going to go and infect my friends. No, they're not going to say that. And we're all in it together. And that, you know, in a way, pandemics give us a secular way of reminding ourselves that we're all in it together. You don't have to come to that conclusion by having a spiritual experience and know that we're all one. I hope you do have that experience, and I do believe that. But if I didn't believe it, I'd be reading Einstein saying, I do not believe that God plays at dice with the universe. I'd be reading him talking about the far reaches of the universe as proof of God's, you know, I love that stuff. Pierre Teilhard-Chardin, I love that stuff. But you don't need to have that stuff to come to the conclusion that we are all in this together. You know, and diversity, this is a big topic in the alt-right. Diversity is not something to me, that is an obligation. It is a celebration. I mean, how could we not want to know what is that little bit of truth that somebody who has a different skin color than we have holds, or a different religion, comes from a different part of the world? I mean, if you're really, if you're like me, and I'm just curious, I think all the big questions are above my pay grade, but I'm still curious, and I'd like to sneak into the, you know, the treasure house of the answers of the meaning of life and steal this one. But I want to know what everybody thinks and every religion thinks about the big questions. And pandemics, because it is the pan part, it is, for me, the perfect metaphor. We're all in it together, and we're really all in it together. So I don't need to have, I don't need to foist my religious or spiritual views on anyone. Just having the word public in front of the word health is good enough for me.
So, you know, going back a long time, you were a hippie in an ashram, and for reasons that I can't begin to comprehend, you were sent back over and over and over again by your guru to get a job at WHO. So, and that was after he was bugging you to try, because that took a few cycles too, right? So tell me, how on earth did that happen? I mean, how on earth did he think that that was the right thing for you to do?
I don't know. I really, truly, honestly don't know. So India, you got to go with me on a trip, you know, to a land far, far away in a time long ago. But the hippie trail that took so many of us in those days, you know, I laugh. I mean, I was a left-wing pinko, and I grew up with, you know, SDS and MCHR, and then I became a hippie and followed every rainbow that I could find, lived on every bus that I could live on, and then I wound up being a spiritual seeker, and then I wound up being a diplomat in a three-piece suit. And that was the career path in those days. I mean, now it sounds really preposterous, but that was what we did. And I wound up, I write about it in the book, I delivered a baby, I helped a woman to deliver her baby on Alcatraz, a Native American woman who was part of the occupation of Alcatraz. And this was a woman named Lou Trudell, and she was a Lakota Sioux. And they gave the baby the name Wovoka, who, the original Wovoka was a Paiute Sioux, who created the ghost dance religion. And it's very interesting, because I love the history of religion. The ghost dance religion, if you remember these white ghost shirts that would protect you against bullets, that is actually based on the fact that Wovoka was born a Mormon and wore Mormon undergarments, which were based, in fact, on Jewish tzitzis. And I just think about how these great ideas migrate. And here's Wovoka, and he's talking that when he died, he would circle the earth in heaven for a period of time, and then he would be reborn. And when he was reborn, the Indian way would return, and then the craziness of the white man's modernity and technology would disappear. And so when this baby was born on Alcatraz, the Indians having taken over Alcatraz, because they had a treaty right to take over Alcatraz, because the Treaty of Laramie said that any federal property seized from Native Americans, upon it being named surplus property, reverted back to the ownership of the Native Americans. That was our treaty. We didn't keep that. And so a group of Native Americans took over. Anyway, after the baby Wovoka was born, I wound up in a Coast Guard cutter going back towards the mainland.
With the baby?
No, the baby was there. I was with a Green Beret. Native American would cut himself and was bleeding maybe to death, and I was sewing him up. But when I got back on the mainland, it seemed like every television camera in the world was pointed in my face, asking me, what do the Indians want? And I had never met a Native American until 3 weeks earlier. And anyway, whatever I did, I got offered a role in a movie by Warner Brothers to play a young doctor. I mean, really, who would make this up? And I played a young doctor in a movie, a terrible movie called The Medicine Ball Caravan about the Grateful Dead, Jefferson Airplane, Pink Floyd. And I became a rock doc, and that ended with a movie, that ended with a concert with Pink Floyd in Canterbury. And then my friend Wavy Gravy, who I had run away with the circus with, he wanted for us to buy a couple more buses and drive from England to Kathmandu, which we did. It took us 2 years. You wonder why it was hard for me to get a publisher for the book. They just didn't believe any of this stuff. And then we wound up living in India, and my wife was really interested in meditation, and she found this guru who had... How many of you read Be Here Now and know who Ram Dass is? I'm just curious. So that book was about my guru named Kiroli Baba. And we wound up living with him. And this is also the same ashram that Steve Jobs lived in, you know, just to drop some names. I was always trying to meditate, and I was never very good at it. I mean, I've always thought there was some kind of an irony in there being a competition to be good at meditating. But if there was, I was never any good at it. And one day I was sitting in the corner and I was trying, you know, to meditate, and my guru kept on throwing apples at me and hitting me in my testicles with the apples. And every time I would kind of start up like that, he would say, it's important to meditate. It's important to do service. It's important to be filled with faith. But you have got something else I want you to do. And I want you to go and give vaccinations in villages and help eradicate this disease, smallpox. And honest to God, I had no idea what he was talking about. I thought, you want me to vaccinate you? I mean, we were speaking in Hindi and a language called Pahari. Actually, what he said to me was, how much money do you have? And I said, I have $500. And he says, you're lying. How much money do you have hidden away in America? And I said, well, I have $500 there too. And then he said in Hindi, $500 here, $500 there, you are no doctor, which is what my mother had said to me. And then he started chanting, you are no doctor, you are no doctor, you are no doctor, UNO doctor, United Nations Organization, you are going to become a United Nations doctor and go to villages and give vaccinations because God is going to lift this one burden, smallpox, from humanity. And if it had ended there, it would be a really nice story, but it didn't end there because he sent me to go to New Delhi to try to find my job at the World Health Organization, which was an austere, very unfriendly place to me as a hippie, wearing an ashram gown that looked for all the world like a white dress and having a beard down to the middle of my tummy and hair down the middle of my back. And I walked in. You can imagine this. This really happened. I walked into the World Health Organization office dressed with my ashram clothes, and this wonderful woman, Edna Boyer, who was at the front desk, she says, who are you and why are you here? And I said, my guru who lives in the Himalayas says that I'm supposed to come and work for you and help eradicate smallpox because God is going to lift this one burden of suffering from humanity. And they kicked me out, of course. And then I went back up to the ashram. My guru said, did you get your job yet? And I said, no, go back. So I went back 15 hours, bus, train, all that stuff. And I went back 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 times before I got the idea, I'm going to put a suit on and cut my hair. And that lasted for 3 or 4 more times. And I was up to about 15, 16 times before I walked in to the World Health Organization. And there was a tall American sitting in the waiting area.
Not that tall.
He was not Bill Fagey tall, but he was about 6'3", 6'4". And he said, and Mrs. Boyer said, you both are American. I had not seen another American at the World Health Organization in all my visits there. And he said, well, who are you? I said, hi, I'm Larry Brilliant. I'm a doctor. I'm living in the Himalayas with my guru. And he said that we're supposed to help eradicate smallpox because it's God's gift to humanity. Who are you? I'm D.A. Henderson. I'm the head of the smallpox program. I've come here from Geneva. We don't have a program yet. We have programs every place else in the world, but not in India, because Mrs. Gandhi hasn't permitted a smallpox program. And he said, but you know, you've come all the way from the Himalayas. I can interview you, and I can put that in your record in case maybe we ever have a smallpox program. And 10 years later, after we had eradicated smallpox, and after I had been running the program in India, and I go back and become a professor at the University of Michigan, go blue. And DA called me from Geneva and said, would you please go back to India and take all of the files and archive them and put them on microfilm? And I couldn't find a place in India that was secure enough for WHO to microfilm them. So WHO shipped them all to Ann Arbor, where there was a microfilm company, and I microfilmed them. And I had all the records. I still have them all. All the records of the smallpox eradication program, which is why I could be accurate about dates and numbers of cases and things. And I confess that I did the absolute unpardonable sin of, while I was microfilming all these records, I did look in my own personnel file, which you're really never supposed to do, and you certainly should never admit it, so don't tell anybody. And I found D.A. Henderson's note to the record, aid memoir, when he interviewed me. He said, I have today interviewed a young man named Larry Brilliant. He says he's a doctor. He doesn't look like one. He says he's supposed to work in the smallpox program for some messianic way. We don't have a job for him, and we probably never will, because he appears to have gone native.
Really?
And D.A. and I became really good friends. I went to his memorial service in December at Johns Hopkins, and he passed away. And D.A. proofread every word that I've written ever about smallpox. And when he read in my book that I wrote that story about him, he called me up and said, okay, can we lose that story? And he was just kidding. I don't know how Maharaji, which is what we used to call my guru, knew that there was a disease called smallpox. I don't know how he inferred or implied or thought or predicted that smallpox would be eradicated. I have to tell you that almost nobody believed we would eradicate smallpox. Now it seems like everything else, you know, as a physician, I know that all medical instruments have shortcomings. There's only one medical instrument that is perfect, and that's the retrospectoscope. And with the benefit of the retrospectoscope, I can tell you that I didn't meet a single high-level official of WHO who thought we could eradicate smallpox, except the smallpox team. And there was one particular guy, just to give you a flavor of this, there was one doctor from Yugoslavia named Ignatovic, who was the head of communicable diseases. He was D.A. Henderson's boss. And he said that this is a fool's errand. You could eradicate smallpox in the United States because it was a developed country. You could eradicate it in Burma because it was a top-down military hierarchy. But you're an idiot if you think you can eradicate smallpox in India or Bangladesh or Nepal or Pakistan. And if you do ever eradicate smallpox, I will eat the tire from a Land Rover. And without a doubt, the happiest day of my life was when Nicole Grasset, who was my boss, DA was our boss's boss, when we went down to the airport, the Palam Airport in New Delhi, with a Land Rover tire in a big box with a note that she wrote in her beautiful French handwriting, Dear Dr. Ignatovic, please let us know of the flavor and the texture, and should you desire any ketchup or mustard or other emollients, they're in the bottom of this box. That was quite a treat. But I don't know how anybody could have had the certainty that Neem Karoli Baba had about smallpox, or how he knew about it, or I mean, he didn't speak English. I don't, you know, I can't answer any of those questions. But I did meet a lot of people in India who seemed to have extraordinary abilities that I, as a scientist, can't, you know, I can't understand. And around him, it was like a game because he was always saying what was going to happen, and we always doubted it, and it always happened. And sometimes it was little tiny things like, you know, from the sublime to the ridiculous. I remember once that we wanted to bring my wife's mother to India. This is just an idea, you know, what it was like in the ashram. And so we went to Maharaji to say, we're not going to be here tomorrow. We're going to New Delhi to pick up my wife's mother, and we're Anne. She's flying in tomorrow. And we didn't miss a beat. I said, she's flying in tomorrow. It's day after tomorrow. I said, no, we're talking about my wife's mother, Girija's mother. She's flying in from the United States tomorrow, day after tomorrow. And of course, you know, we go to the airport, drive to New Delhi, go to the airport and wait for the airplane, and telegram comes, delayed, coming day after tomorrow. I mean, that's trivial, right? But that's the thing that happened all the time. So you kind of got used to it and inured to it and forgot about it. So this is like a, there he's calling right now. It's either Maharaji or Steve Bannon. I'm not sure. Sorry. Don't mean, no, sorry. It ain't the former.
Well, you know, you mentioned the rock and roll movie, but you were a movie star in India too, right?
Oh. So is that where these pink things are? You know, the first few chapters are the sex, drugs, and rock and roll stuff before our... So we bought these two psychedelic painted buses in London. One was a British Leyland transport. The other was a German Mann bus. And we drove to India and then drove into Kathmandu. I have to tell you that when we lived in Iran, Afghanistan, in Turkey, in Iraq, in Pakistan, in India, we followed a book written by Hermann Hesse called Journey to the East. And every night, Wavy would read us a chapter from Journey to the East with a megaphone because we had two buses. And in that book, the protagonist, who is a spiritual seeker, he stops at every church, every mosque, every temple, every synagogue, every Buddhist vihar to pray. And we did that, the 40 hippies. I mean, we were actually 40 young people living on two buses and everybody sleeping with everybody else, but we stopped at every place we could to pray. And we would also stop in villages, and we had a box that had all of Wavy's toys, and he would pull out his toys and blow bubbles and give the kids toys. And I had my medical supplies, and I would sew people up or give them little whatever I could do to treat people. And I remember, like, we went to a Kurdish village at the foot of Mount Ararat, and we went into this Muslim community, and in the very center of the village, they had a small mosque, and in it they had a picture of Mecca. And sometimes we'd go into a Buddhist village, same thing, we'd go into it, in the center of it there'd be an idol, an image of Buddha. Hindu village, Vishnu or Shiva. Christian village, there'd be a cross, or very often a picture of a painting of Mary. And not all the time, but 2 out of 10 times, right next to that picture of Mecca or that image of Buddha or Vishnu or that cross or image of Mary, 2 out of 10 times, right next to that holiest, most sacred image in the center of the town, there'd be a picture of John F. Kennedy. And that was not because we were perfect people. That was not because America didn't have concentration camps for Japanese or didn't use nuclear weapons or that we didn't come close to a genocide of Native Americans. Wasn't that we were perfect. But aspirationally, we were something that in that village, as poor as they were, they thought of us not just as the single superpower in the world, but they thought of us sort of as a rich uncle, as somebody who could bring order to the chaos of their lives. And maybe one day they would be able to send their kids to a school here and be an immigrant to this country. And that's what we are losing. And that's what we have to get back again. Because the world is a dangerous place in reality. And we need to have a strong America. And we need to deserve that feeling that we that I felt, that these little villagers showed to me. And you have to understand that when we drove into these villages in these two big 40-foot-long psychedelic buses, we looked like Martians. And everybody was so kind to us in Iran, in Iraq. And that was somehow how I wound up going to India. And so you want to know about the movie. I was trying to duck it. But so we got our buses, our funny little psychedelic buses, and we came into Kathmandu. And we got visas to go walk up to Mustang, this great kingdom in the corner of Tibet and Nepal. And while we were waiting for the visas to come into effect, we were living at a place just outside of Kathmandu called Swayambhu. You've probably seen the eyes of Buddha, which are the symbol of the Seva Foundation. We chose those symbols because we lived under those eyes at the top of this Buddhist monastery in Swayambhu. So our buses were parked there, and we were pretty obviously hippies. There was no doubt about that. You could see that from the color of our painting on our buses. And a Indian movie producer named Devanand came up to our buses and said that he was doing a movie about the spiritual quest of the hippies and why all these young Americans and French and Brits had come to India to search for the spiritual truth that was only in India. And he wanted to make a movie about that. And he wanted some extras to play in that movie. And we believed him. And he tricked us. And instead he made a movie which became almost the anthem. It could have been called, the name of the movie was Hare Krishna, Hare Rama, but it could have been called We've Come for Your Daughters. Or These Are the People Your Mother Warned You Against. My wife and I acted in that movie. Wavy Gravy and his wife acted in the movie. All 40 of the hippies are in that movie. It was the first movie of Zita Anand, who was a very famous Indian cinema star and musician. And the anthem of the movie was dum-ma-da-dum. Okay, how many know what that means? Mit-da-jaya-gum. And it's a puff after puff. We smoked hashish all night. I became, I'm visible in the movie. My wife is more visible than me, thank God. And I just have to tell you that everywhere I went in India for the first 3 years after that movie, when I was working for WHO in the smallpox program, that movie wound up showing up in my life. And once I remember trying to persuade the health minister of India named Karan Singh, to persuade this wonderful man why smallpox was so important. And I had my briefing books and I had my charts and my graphs, and I was trying to get permission to go into some place like Bhutan that you couldn't go into. And I'm trying to explain to him why smallpox eradication was so important. And after I'd finished my presentation, I looked at him to see, was he gonna let us do this? He looked at me and said, yes, no problem. And I said, really? Good. Why? He said, because dum-ma-da-dum.
That's great. You know, you mentioned John F. Kennedy. And one of the things that is quite shocking for me coming back to this country is that I think that the U.S. is the only country not at war where maternal mortality is increasing. So when you speak of, you know, the 100 years before, we're certainly not a perfect country, we certainly have not been perfect, but the badness has been decreasing over time. And all of a sudden it's increased in a very big way, all of a sudden. I can't help but think that part of that was laid because
of the same things that have contributed to the increase in maternal mortality. You implied that hopefully this is temporary, but I'm wondering what your thinking is about how we jump up and wrest it back. Where did we go wrong? Why did the arc of history suddenly take a nosedive?
But I don't think it has. I think that it, what's the saying? Where you stand is where you sit. We have fewer wars than ever in the last 200 years, 300 years. We have fewer wars. We have fewer men, women standing in uniform, jeopardizing their lives than we've ever had before. I mean, admittedly, there's asymmetrical war and there's terrorism and all the other reasons, but net-net, it's fewer.
Globally, there's no question.
We have increased life expectancy, decreased child mortality. I have to remind myself that I would go into little villages in the smallpox program trying to sell the idea of eradicating one disease while I was talking to mothers in an area where 50% of the children died before the age of 5 from vaccine-preventable diseases. And now, because of the Gates Foundation and others, we've flipped that ratio. Instead of having 80% of kids unvaccinated, we have 80% of kids vaccinated. And there's no place left on Earth, really, where 50% of children die before the age of 5. And you look at literacy, you look at women's literacy especially, which is the key to looking at population. And on all these metrics, it's not worse. It feels a lot worse today. It didn't feel like this 6 months ago.
No.
We have to remember that these movements of the tsunami that we're feeling right now, we need to defeat that, both the reality of it and our head, the fear of it. So I don't agree that it's that we've fallen into a sinkhole. Here's the thing. I mean, I'm not an economist or a political scientist, but I'm fascinated by those dismal sciences. I hope I'm not insulting anybody here, but it's a term economists talk about their own field. But I think that if you look at what has happened on a big, if you could go out into space and look back, you would see that in the last 50 years, we as a species have taken 500 million people out of absolute poverty and propelled them into the middle class. I mean, 300 million in China, maybe 400 million, 100 million in India. People who were living on less than a dollar a day, wretched lives, Francis Fanon kind of wretched of the earth. I mean, this is a wonderful thing that's happened. Now, what Trump says, and there's an element of truth in it, although he's 20 years late in saying it, is that bringing 500 million, half a billion people out of poverty was done on the backs of American workers who now are living in hollowed out communities where the industrial heartland of Pennsylvania and Michigan and Ohio is gone. I'm from Detroit. I grew up in Detroit. I think there's an element of truth in that, although it's 20 years late. China is not coming to the United States right now to get our jobs on assembly lines. They're trying to get our advanced robotics and artificial intelligence, and that's what's causing the loss of jobs. I mean, if you doubt that, if you doubt that this myth that we are exporting jobs to Mexico because of a couple of factories going down there, if you doubt that, just do a mind experiment with me. Do a Sherlock Holmes kind of, mind vault with me. My friends on the tech side, they're all gung-ho about driverless cars and, automatic driving cars. And I have a lot of friends at Tesla. Well, let's go there in just a second. They haven't gone there yet. But if you think that we've seen something that could propel a populist like Trump because of the loss of jobs due to exporting of our labor force, now let's say that we in technology in Silicon Valley win this golden prize of driverless cars, automatic driving. And now we ask ourselves, how many drivers are there who earn their income by taxi drivers or bus drivers or truck drivers or locomotive drivers or school bus drivers? It is close to 30 million. Now, how do you make public policy? What happens to the Ayn Randians and the, you know, who want to have, you know, freedom from any kind of regulation? Go ahead, bring that technology in. I mean, you know, come on, we'd all like to sit in the back seat of a driverless car for a minute or two. But I don't want the negative effect on democracy that happens if we suddenly lose 30 million jobs. And it's not just in the United States, it's all over the developed world. How are we going to have an adult conversation about that? What venue do we have that we can have a conversation about that kind of effect? That's a bigger challenge in a secular way than what I hope is a 2-year blip on the screen from Trump. Although I realize I'm being ridiculously optimistic, but still.
I'm going to open it up, but I'll just make one observation. A week ago, it came to me that one of the reasons that I was feeling so bad is that, unlike previous disasters that have happened sort of exogenously, this one, I didn't do as much as I could have.
Yeah.
I did less this time around than I did for Obama because I thought it was impossible.
Yeah.
In fact, I was actually, confession, hoping that Trump would be the Republican candidate.
Yeah. Me too.
And as a result, I realized that one of the reasons this was so hard for me, and my kids grew up in Mexico and feel that they're Mexican, and so this has been, from a family perspective, complicated, was the feeling of guilt because we didn't take this seriously. And history has, you know, taught us some pretty serious lessons about when you don't take people seriously who spread hate and blame others and divide people. I think you're exactly right that the world has been getting dramatically better. I think you're exactly right that, of course, it is 20 years too late. But I think it's also true that when the world isn't getting better for people, we see the rise of what's happening. I mean, Le Pen could win in France. We could see the end of the European Union. The negotiator for the EU just went back to Europe and said, the three biggest threats to the European Union are Brexit, Putin, and Trump. So I don't think it's far-fetched to think that we could see the collapse of the European Union. And the combination of those things for the investments that you've mentioned in global development and global health that many people in this room have spent their lives working on, you know, there is a bleak scenario out there, which I don't think is going to actually happen because I'm actually an optimist and I think that the next 2 years are going to see mobilization like we haven't seen for a very long time. But I'm curious about, first of all, what your thought is on the guilt part. Maybe that's my Catholic upbringing rather than something more currently spiritual. But and what it implies for what we should do. Because I think part of the guilt is also feeling like we've been worrying about little things.
Yeah.
I mean, to take one clear example, we've spent a lot of energy in the last year and a half worrying about the response to Black Lives Matter in the university, in the school, worrying about microaggressions in the classroom. And I have to say, you know, I woke up in November thinking, what the hell we were doing? We should have been in Ohio, not worrying about microaggressions. I'm curious what your sense is.
Well, I came from New York on Saturday and went through SFO. And so I walked over to the international terminal and I was able to participate in this incredible, spontaneous, resistance movement. And I was really pleased to see that my friend from Google, because I worked at Google for a long time, Sergey Brin was there. And he was saying that, look, folks, I'm an immigrant too. And I don't know, maybe this is wrong and naive, but this bargain that we've made, this trade-off, I mean, within the constraints of global warming and a kind of fixed carbon budget that the world has, the development community has tried to make this trade-off to take hundreds of millions of people out of poverty. I mean, there's almost a direct linear relationship between taking people out of poverty and hitting your carbon budget. just fossil fuels are, you know, one of the most important elements in economic development until we have clean energy that's cheaper than coal, which we do have now in most places. But I think that this bargain of, if we had gone, you know, somehow Deus et Machina, you and I were elected as co-emperors, and we had gone and asked people if they'd be willing to give up 20% of their income or 10% of their income. If I went back to my friends I grew up with in Detroit and said, would you give up growth in your income in exchange for taking 500 million people out of abject poverty? And I think if we had phrased it that way, if we had had that kind of a national conversation, if we had given ourselves time to think about the moral imperatives, and we would have voted for it, we would have gone for it, if there had been a plebiscite or a referendum. But nobody asked, and everybody lied about the, not about global warming, we never lied about global warming. We did lie about the linkage between a kind of fixed carbon budget and a fixed rate of growth. And I think that that's where I feel guilty. I feel guilty that the charge of elitism fits heavy on my shoulders. And you know, I'm a first-generation American. I'm the first kid in my family to graduate from high school. And yet how easy it was for me to make a cultural affinity with the elites of Silicon Valley and the Medicis. That's where my guilt comes from. Why didn't I make common cause with the people who became Trump voters? They're not bad people, you know. I mean, there is not more racism today in America than there was on November 5th. There is not more sexism than there was on November 5th. There's not more xenophobia against Mexicans than there was on November 5th. There's not more hatred of Islam than there was on November 5th. But what's happened is that the Trump phenomenon has given people license to express those feelings. And the internet has created a common set of communications channels. The alt-right didn't exist as a named entity a year ago. And it, you know, people were Nazis, they were racist, there were people who hated black people, people who hated Muslims, people who hated Jews, but they sort of were super specialized in who they hated. And now the combination of the internet and this political season has allowed people who hate to become a movement. And we need to learn from that as we create our movement, that we don't balkanize our movement by saying, you know, we're anti-racist or we're anti-Semitism or anti-Islam, and we separate ourselves. We've got to come together and realize that the challenge for us is to bring back a world of peace and prosperity and bring back the sovereignty of ideas and science and love. That's the meta lesson, I think, for me. And the guilt that I have is this, I mean, what the hell am I doing living in Marin as an elitist? If anybody should have learned, I should have learned better.
You know, I think I agree with almost all of that. But I think that the piece that I would add is that when we lied about the fact that the burden wouldn't be borne fairly.
That's right.
So I think that people, you know, in the rebuilding of Europe and Japan after the war, they agreed to a common sacrifice. They agreed to a common sacrifice to be in the war, even. But I think this time, we've borne that sacrifice unfairly,
yeah,
and we've been unwilling as a society to take care of the people who were, you know, who got the short end of the stick for whatever reason.
Well, that begs a bigger, maybe not bigger, but it begs the question of whether unfettered capitalism and democracy can coexist. I mean, I had a conversation with Larry Summers, who used to, when he was fired at Harvard, he hid out in Silicon Valley, and we used to have dinners with him, and we would talk about economic development. He said, well, you know, macroeconomics can solve all the problems that we face. I said, really? Yeah, macroeconomic theory. He said, except for two. And I said, okay, what are those? He said, externalities and market failures. And the sledgehammer is the arrogance of thinking that we can trim the ugly edges of capitalism and put it in a cage and tame it so that it won't destroy democracy. And then you can have democracy. But we should have learned that, whether it was the lies that led up to Brexit or the lies that led up to Trump, that the manipulation of the press or all these different things. And democracy is a very fragile flower. And we didn't fertilize it. We didn't water it. We didn't protect it. We certainly didn't keep on saying every time the media engaged in hyperbole that that was not right. We don't have ombudsmen. We don't any longer have public intellectuals who would, you know, not just Walter Cronkite, for those of you old enough to remember that, but we don't have public intellectuals who are riding herd on the excesses of political debate and dialogue. But most of all, we have failed in the core promise that we made as Americans to each other, which is that we would accept the inequality that derived from innovation and entrepreneurship, provided we had a safety net for everybody who didn't get lucky, didn't win the lucky sperm contest, didn't have the great idea or have good timing in their business. We'd protect them with the safety net. And we lied. We didn't do it. We failed. And that's what we're seeing now, is that when we the rich and the powerful got better and better at gaming the system, and we, with the public in front of public health and everybody else who says that they, you know, see the world as we do, we didn't keep the bargain of that safety net. And we didn't keep it in countries. In England didn't keep it, and we didn't keep it in America. And that's what we're going to have to be repairing and being honest with each other, honest with ourselves. Because we're going to take back our country. We are. And we're going to be better for it and stronger for it. It's going to be painful, and there may be casualties. And there will be casualties. There are already casualties. But we will win. And it's just that we need to be honest, or we can't possibly win the right war.
Yeah, the remark you made about the internet, it just made me think back to the start on infectious diseases. Extraordinary advances in speed of physical transport, airplanes, trains, et cetera, made it a whole lot easier and faster for infectious diseases to spread. Since I was in Africa with the internet was this extraordinary thing which brought, you know, I could have access to Harvard libraries sitting in Kinshasa the way it used to. You used to have to go to Cambridge or Huntington Avenue to do that. But we didn't think about the fact that it also provided the canals for hate to spread and link, so that, you know, what you say is very true. Well, I want to open it up. I don't want to hog the microphone. But it would be really nice to have a microphone. because since we're recording, it'd be nice to record the question, not just the answer. So I'll walk around if somebody wants to raise their hand. Everybody's Larry. Do me a favor and introduce yourself.
I'm Larry Green, an alumni three times here. And I had the privilege of working with D.A. Henderson at Hopkins, and then I had the privilege of working with Bill Fagey in the federal government.
They can't hear you.
Pretend you're speaking to the back, even though there's a microphone.
Oh, okay, sorry. So my question is, why is there such debate about which of the two of them deserves the credit for the smallpox eradication?
Well, I think the question is who deserves the credit for smallpox eradication between Bill Fagey and D.A. Henderson? There's a lot of people who deserve the credit. Professor Vladimir Zhdanov, the Russian head of the Academy of Sciences, who came forward at a World Health Assembly meeting in 1965 and proposed that the world take on the eradication of smallpox. This is long before Bill or DA were in it. And the world had failed three times. We had taken on malaria eradication, we failed. We had taken on yaws, and we'd failed. We had taken on yellow fever, and we'd failed. And there wasn't a lot of get up and go in the World Health Assembly, and he just hammered and hammered and hammered. And the U.S. agreed to go along. I mean, to me, he's one of the great heroes. The entire Czechoslovakian epidemiological community are heroes. They made the greatest epidemiologists in the world, and they were in every country all over the world. Alex Langmuir, who created the Epidemic Intelligence Service, so that we had the opportunity for all these young people to go right from medical school or college and go in and get out and work in epidemiology. And I could go on and on. I mean, Nicole Grasset, the French-Swiss heroine of the piece. And WHO, as much as all of us have a love-hate relationship with WHO, and if you don't have a love-hate relationship with WHO, it's because you never worked with them. But WHO, we couldn't have eradicated smallpox without WHO. Larry's referring to the acrimony, and by the way, both these guys won the Presidential Medal of Honor and the Lasker Prize and every award you could think of, except the Nobel Prize, and part of the reason that WHO didn't get the Nobel Prize was a little of this acrimony. D.A. Henderson ran the smallpox eradication program. He had run the Epidemic Intelligence Service. He didn't want to take the job running the smallpox eradication program. The Russians wanted an American to run the program because other than Zhdanov, the Russians were 99% certain we would fail. And what better person to pin it on than an energetic, somewhat aggressive man than D.A. Henderson? And D.A. didn't want to take it, but he took it. And he ran it, and we would never have seen a global program that had doctors from 170 countries if it wasn't for DA's chutzpah and his, you know, D.A. Henderson looked like a football coach. He gave commands like a czar, and he was charismatic as you've ever heard. He was amazing. But he had the wrong strategy. And the first 10 years of smallpox eradication, first 9 years, was based on mass vaccination. And everybody in public health understands this. You can't eradicate smallpox in Cleveland, Ohio, by vaccinating everybody in Tokyo. It just doesn't work. And the strategy in the smallpox program that DA was following was vaccinate everybody. Well, that works maybe in a place like the United States, or as I mentioned earlier, in Burma. But in India, which had 600 million people, and every year 30 million new babies, as many as Australia or Canada had,
had people,
that's right. How you couldn't vaccinate everybody because by the time you made your annual rounds, there'd be more people to get smallpox. And this actually brings us back to the conversation we had before, which is the relationship between kind of religion and public health. Bill Fagy was a Lutheran missionary in Nigeria during the Civil War. He was in the Igbo part of Nigeria, and he was running a hospital, a Lutheran hospital, and there was an outbreak of smallpox. And Bill ran out of vaccine. It's like the Maccabees story. Bill ran out of vaccine, and he tried to ask himself, what is the most ethical and moral way that I can allocate this life-saving resource, smallpox vaccine? Who do I give it to? And he started to pray and to think, both. Science and God. And he said, well, look, maybe if I just vaccinate the people who are in the same household with smallpox patients, the people who are most directly affected and most at risk, and I won't vaccinate the ministers, and I won't vaccinate the rich people who are coming in the door for smallpox, I'll just go vaccinate the people who need it the most. And he did that, and smallpox disappeared in 6 weeks. And it had never been done before. It makes all the sense in the world. Bring on that retrospectoscope, it makes perfect sense. But the idea of doing selective epidemiologic control, which was what the title was of his article in the American Journal of Epidemiology that got him and DA kind of crosswise with each other, he proposed that the WHO take on that strategy, and it took a little while. But when we took on that strategy, and then Bill brought that strategy to India, I was already in the smallpox program, and Bill showed up in India bringing this idea of search and containment. We took that idea, and Nicole Grasset and all these amazing Indians, MID Sharma, Mahendra Dutta. I mean, let's not forget that WHO spent $150 million to eradicate smallpox, but every country in the world spent 10 times that and gave 10 times more people. I mean, they're the people who really were the heroes and eradicated smallpox. But we not only went to vaccinate people who were most at risk, we had to find every case of smallpox. And we visited every house in India every month for 20 months. We made 2 billion house calls. So Bill's mystical experience of giving the vaccine to people who are most in need were translated by the bureaucrats and by DA and by the foot soldiers and the 150 doctors and 150,000 workers. It was translated into 2 billion house calls. They're all heroes. So we now, in our refined way, we argue whether Bill's contribution was more or DA's contribution was more. But I think we're missing the beauty of this. We're missing the rainbow. We're missing the fact that it was people from all over the world. And all these amazing young Indians who, you know, what did we give up? You know, I lived in India for 10 years. I wasn't giving up anything. It was wonderful. But these folks gave up everything. I had a paramedical assistant. I'd like to mention his name, Zafar Hussain, who, you know, gave his life to eradicate smallpox. And he's a hero. So understand, you know, there's a debate. And, you know, I'll tell you that Bill gave the eulogy for DA at his service.
Nice to see you, Larry. My name's Dana Ullman, and I graduated from the School of Public Health in 78. And in the late 70s and 80s, Bill Gates and his contributions to funding vaccine programs wasn't happening. And I remember hearing that throughout Africa, a lot of the vaccine programs were so underfunded that the sterilization for needles was inadequate, and they were often sharing needles. And in the late 80s, the science editor of the Times of London did a front page story that suggested that one of the ways that AIDS spread was because of the smallpox vaccine programs that were reusing needles. And although there was that one article one time, no one ever talks about this.
Oh.
maybe I missed it. But here's the challenge, and this is a drama that is facing public health now on vaccines, about the value of them, but the safety of them. And at what point do public health people come forward and admit error?
Well, we should admit all of our errors, but that was not one of them. And I will tell you that after we eradicated smallpox, and I remember coming back to the United States just so proud of what we'd done, and I felt so, you know, don't people know what we did? And you know, I commissioned a survey when I was at the University of Michigan, the Survey Research Center. 9% of Americans knew that smallpox had been eradicated. That's 91 by my counting who didn't. And it seemed like every one of them called me in the middle of the night to tell me about the Esquire magazine article that said that the smallpox vaccine had created HIV/AIDS. When I was living in Ann Arbor, we would get calls 3 in the morning, 4 in the morning. Somebody would find an old Esquire magazine that had that article in it and call me up and say, what the hell have you done? So the first thing is we didn't reuse needles in smallpox. We didn't use those kinds of needles. We used something called a bifurcated needle. And it was originally a sewing needle. And a guy named, his last name was Ruben, working for Geigy, had experimented. It was a sewing needle. He wanted to figure out how you could get a meniscus that had exactly a dose sufficient to vaccinate one person. And of course, once he cut off the tip of that needle, the two tines could hold a little drop of water. Then he figured out backwards what should be the concentration of the vaccine. Another hero, by the way. What should be the concentration of the vaccine? And by doing that, there was no inoculation. There was no opportunity for reusing those needles. They were one time and then disposable. We manufactured.
Because you couldn't inject something else. You wouldn't use it for an injection.
You would never use it for anything else. And we manufactured, I think, 10 billion of those needles. And probably the sin that we made is they're probably still in landfills in India today. So, no, we may have been guilty of a lot of things, but we were not guilty of starting or perpetuating HIV/AIDS. And in fact, the real article was that it was the experiment that was done in Africa, in Congo, to see if the vaccine was, you know, used, that experiment. This is what was in the article. And it was wrong, and it's in the same category as Andrew Wakefield's article in Lancet, that he was paid $385,000 by a lawyer who wanted to sue vaccine companies. And so he manufactured a fake news that vaccinations were linked to autism. There are a lot of bad things about smallpox eradication. Let me tell you some of them. In order to make the vaccine, we had to kill cows in India. That was that created some of the worst resistance to vaccination that I've ever seen. It continues in India in many ways. We operated under the 1895 Bengal Immunity Act, which gave a public health officer the right to forcibly vaccinate people in an epidemic if they weren't willing to take a vaccine. I forcibly vaccinated people. I regret that. But I don't regret it enough to think I shouldn't have done it. It's one of the hardest things in public health. It's like saying the freedom doesn't extend to yelling fire in a crowded theater. We have to understand at what point the whole and the Vulcan idea that the needs of many are greater than the desires of a few. The biggest thing that we did wrong was that a vertical program like smallpox, because it was important in the United States but not in India or Bangladesh, it was like, you know, it would have been the 100th most important thing to do. Because we were Americans and we had money, and we started, by the way, the first special funds that WHO ever, the first money that WHO ever got that wasn't budgeted by the UN process were the special donations for smallpox eradication, because in the West, smallpox was a big priority for us. So we persuaded the Indian government for periods of time that all the malaria workers and all the family planning workers and all the cholera workers and all the sanitary inspectors would be seconded, deputed to the smallpox program. I don't think I'd ever heard the term opportunity cost. But we depleted every other program in India for 3 years. And that was the same all over the world. And we argued, and I think convincingly so, and I believe it at some level, that give us your sanitary inspectors and your malaria workers and your family planning workers for 3 years, we'll eradicate the disease and we'll give you back all the smallpox workers. Didn't turn out that way. So there's a lot of things that are negative about smallpox eradication, but we didn't cause or contribute to the spread of HIV/AIDS.
We'll take one more because I think the wine is waiting for us.
Hi, I'm Linda Rudolph with the Center for Climate Change and Health at the Public Health Institute.
Aren't you mad that CDC canceled that meeting?
Well, others have picked up the slack.
It's at the Carter Center, I know. It's going to be great.
So, you mentioned this sort of, you know, balance between the fossil fuel budget and development. And the Lancet Commission on Planetary Health had a sort of a different take on that balance, which is that we've mortgaged the health of future generations in order to achieve economic and development gains in the present. And I'm just wondering what your thoughts are on the role of the public health and philanthropic communities in making sure that we don't blow past our carbon budget in the next 5 years in a way that really commits us to catastrophic climate change that will undo all the kinds of health and development gains you rightfully are, you know, pleased with in this current time.
Well, first of all, I think you're right. I think that not consciously, that I don't think there was a committee meeting and people said let's mortgage the future to get economic development or public health gains today. I have so many things I want to say all at once, but I remember going in Manila to WIPRO, the WHO regional office for the Pacific, for Western Pacific, and I was at Google at the time, and we were very energetically working on renewables. We had a formula that WHO being, Google being engineers, it was RE less than C. This was the formula, which is the price of a watt of energy from a renewable. We had to drive it down below the price of a watt of energy from coal, carbon, but coal. I was going around. I went to the WHO office there, and I went to the person who was the regional director for climate change and health. This was probably 2009. And we talked about what they were responsible for. They were responsible for, in a 9-country region, mitigating climate change effects on health, and educating people about the linkage between climate change and health. And their budget for those 9 countries was $25,000 a year. So if you look at it the way you're describing it, we didn't take climate change seriously. It is hard to explain that an odorless, tasteless, invisible gas can mortgage the future the way you describe. I work with Jeff Skoll, and I've been running for a long time the Skoll Global Threats Fund, and I'm on the board of the Skoll Foundation, and Jeff is a good friend of mine. And he was the producer of Inconvenient Truth. He talked Al Gore into doing it, and last week, we released the sequel, and it's called Inconvenient Sequel. And I think it addresses exactly the things that you're talking about, and it features Al again, and it is, it's poignant. I think is what, it'll make you ache that since that movie 10 years ago, we have lost so many chances to get it right. And this is another part of the, it's true for Brexit, it's true for Le Pen, it's true for Trump. They're not willing to make any long-term trade-offs for short-term gains. And to deal with climate change, you have to make these trade-offs. And what you said is completely right.
Well, I want to thank you all for coming. And most especially, I want to thank Larry for spending this time with us.
Thank you. Thank you, Scott. It's great to be back. It's really nice to be back and be here in Berkeley. Thank you so much for inviting me.
We have wine and some books outside, I think.